Well, good morning to everyone and welcome to GCA. I see a lot of familiar faces from ABC Land as well. Just wanted to say thank you all for joining us for this workshop. Some amazing information is going to be shared. I'm with you. I'm in listen mode today, listen and learn. That's what we're doing today, but I definitely wanted to share with you all. I am Lynn Demons here, Vice President of Business Development with GCA and Customer Care and Support Services. But what I wanted to share with you are a couple of dates of things that we have happening here. Put these on your calendar to make sure that you are aware. You should have received some documents once you've entered and registered or checked in with us today. We have this week, first and foremost, this was not a flyer, but we do have the certification boot camp that will be occurring here on Thursday. For those of you who are interested in getting support in regards to the certifications for your business, it's a significant opportunity for you to get that help that you need. That is tomorrow, June 20th, and that event is also on Facebook. If you go to Government Contractors Association, go to our events and you'll see the event listed there. In addition to that, we have the capability pitch contest that is coming up, which is a significant opportunity for you to pitch your business. And there's a prize package worth $30,000 to help you in supporting you and your business plan. That will be here on July the 10th. So if you go to govevent.com, you can get registered for this event. It is guaranteed not to be a disappointment. The capability pitch contest. I also wanted to share with you, put this on your calendars as well. Our heavy hitters and big spenders, okay? Event in August, that's August 22nd here at this location as well. This is where we'll provide the opportunity to showcase those capabilities and support. That's August 22nd, 9 to 1 here at GCA. So with those, without further ado, after our session today, please complete the evaluation form as well so that we can get your feedback, because that's important to us as we move forward and provide the information that is going to be helpful for our membership. And without further ado, I'll pass the baton, if you will, to none other than Mr. Abraham Chung. Did I say that correctly?
That's good. All right. Well, hey, good morning, everybody. It's good to see everybody out here.
Now, I haven't been up here because we have such an awesome staff and awesome team here. So I'm treasuring this moment that I get to be in front of all of you and share about, you know, the government contracting market and my experience with it. Today, we got an awesome topic. We're going to be talking about how to get free furniture. Who likes free? So you guys are smart. Ladies and gentlemen, you're the smart one that showed up, and we got people online also. All of you online, you're smart people, because free means free. And I'm going to talk about how to get free furniture, laptop equipment, printers, desk, anything that you need for your business. The government has resources that can be made available to small businesses. And we're going to talk all those details in a second here. For those of you joining us online, just want to make sure that you can hear us okay. And I've got all of you on mute, but in the chat area, if you could just type in there, yes, you can hear us okay. And let us know that audio is coming through fine online. Now, for those of you who are here physically, I'm excited that you're here, because I want to encourage you for physically coming, because it takes more effort, right? And the reason why I want to reward that, coming online is awesome, so I'm glad you guys are online. But when you come here physically, you understand the government market a little bit better. Not because, you know, part of it is because when you attend anything physically in person, you're gonna get more value out of it. But in the government market, it's not about convenience. It's not about you sitting back in your office and the government's coming to you. That's not how it works in the government market. In the government market, you have to get out of your comfort zone, out of your comfortable office, and go to the agencies that engage them at their terms, not necessarily them coming to engage you on your terms. So to do that,
I'm giving out a free t-shirt. GCA t-shirt. And to do, to give this away, we're gonna do the stand up or the sit down game more so. So it's called the sit down game. And so we're gonna start off with the game. And the winner gets a t-shirt and gets a 50% discount to our boot camp, all day boot camp tomorrow. Now I'll talk more about the boot camp in a second, but you get 50% discount to the one day, all day boot camp tomorrow. So it's gonna be awesome. And for any reason you can't attend, find somebody else that can attend for you. So everybody stand up and we're gonna play this game here. So let me pull up my notes, because the sit down game, this is how it works. I'm gonna say a statement, and if it's true to you, then you sit down. And the last person standing gets a t-shirt and the discount, all right? So that's how the game works. So let me, my wife and kids says I need glasses, but I told them I don't. So I have to zoom in a little bit so I can keep proving them wrong. All right, so if I say the statement and it's true, it applies to you, then you sit down. Sit down if you got coffee from McDonald's or QT this morning. Wow, no one went to QT or McDonald's for coffee. All right. That's good. That means don't fall asleep in my class though, okay? Sit down if you haven't told your spouse or significant other that you love them in the last few days. Oh, wow, you guys love your
if you have it.
If you have not.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
What if you don't have a spouse?
Maybe your kids or significant other, whoever your significant other, it could be a friend, it could be a boyfriend, it could be a girlfriend, it could be anybody. All right. So that's good. You guys are all still standing up. Sit down if you have to pay for your own Father's Day or Mother's Day dinner.
Oh, got somebody.
If you have to pay for it,
even if I transferred it to her account, so she can feel good.
If it came from you, if it's your money, then sit down, right?
Oh, wait a minute. That's not a good question. I have to end up. Everybody who didn't pay.
Yeah, I might change it that way next time. All right, sit down if you have attended less than 3 GCA training events. If you've attended less than 3 GCA events, any type of events that GCA have had, if you've attended less than 3, sit down. All right, a few. See, you got to fall in love with GCA. You got to keep coming to classes. See? All right, sit down if you don't like to travel.
What?
You don't like to travel, sit down. All of you love to travel. Okay, good. Sit down if you did work out last week. Didn't go running, didn't go to the gym.
Didn't work out.
You don't work out. So that means you went to the gym, you went to the park, you did some type of exercise. All right, so we got some folks that's actually, you know, working on being healthy consistently. That's good. Sit down if you're not registered in SAM.gov. If you're not registered. All right, so we got one person left. That's awesome. Woo! Because I have some really good, you know, stuff coming, but
thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much. I'll actually honor
you. See, I was getting to the good one. Sit down if you did not bathe every day. So I'm glad I didn't call anybody out with that one, but we were getting to that one next. But I got one more certificate, so pay attention during the class here, because at the end of today's class, I've got a question, and the person that has the right answer to it gets this certificate here. So don't fall asleep on me, those of you that did not get coffee from QT and McDonald's this morning. All right, so let's dive in. Let me make sure my clicker is working. All right, so this is what you're going to be learning today. You're going to be learning how small business can get free laptops, cell phones, furniture, equipment. That's what we're going to be talking about today. You're going to learn who can get these surplus items. And then you're also going to learn how to save money by using surplus properties and how to take advantage of these surplus products so that you can have a competitive edge in the government market, and then how to qualify as a business to get these free surplus properties. And then we're gonna talk about how you can take advantage of any program so that you can access these free properties, and how you can use the VSBEA surplus program for veterans businesses. And then we're gonna talk about how public servants or nonprofits and education organizations can take advantage of these programs as well. And then we're gonna talk about what is SASP and how SASP can give you these items. And then we're gonna talk about, you know, answer the question, can you resell these items, and other guidelines related to this program here, this free furniture, free surplus property program. Now, this next slide here. And then we're going to talk about, last thing is, you know, well, actually two more things, how to get your business certified so that you can fully take advantage of the program. Now here, I'm going to give you all these links here. In fact, for those of you online, if you shoot an email to info@govcontractors.org, we'll get you this slide here so that you don't have to, if you don't take all the notes, because these links are kind of long. Now, for those of you who are here in class, you can take a picture of it, or Richard is actually gonna print out and hand it out to you in a second. So he's printing out this document so that you can actually use these links here, because we're gonna cover all these links, and you need to use these links here to take advantage of the program. All right, so let me share a little about myself. Some of you know me, you've heard my story, but my name is Abraham Xiong. I am originally from Laos. Laos, L-A-O-S. Anybody know or been to Laos? You been to Ghana in Laos?
No.
Anybody been to Southeast Asia, like Thailand, Cambodia, Laos, yeah. Vietnam? Yeah. Thailand? Okay. Yeah, how was your experience in Thailand?
I heard it was great.
It's great?
All right. Waterfall.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, awesome. Well, before I go into a lot about me, let's do a, you get 15 seconds to share about your name, your company, and something unique or special about you to the group here. So why don't we start off with you, Mr. Tyler? 15 seconds. Your name, stand up, your name, business name, what your business is about, and something special about you.
My name is Evan Moore. The name of my business is IQ Telecom Solutions. Something special about me is I'm a Marine. I'm a good guy.
So, okay. Awesome. Well, thank you for your service.
Thank you.
All right. But next here.
My name is Pam Medlock Smith. I am a retired registered nurse. I don't have a name exactly for my business, but it entails the fact that I've seen a lot of people doing CPR incorrectly or not knowing what to do when the crisis is upon them. So I would like to be that person to teach people how to do CPR correctly.
Okay, awesome. Next.
My name is Marina Douglas. My business, Global Marketing Branded Solutions. We bring solutions to your business that help your business grow, get more leads, generate more ROI for your business.
All right.
Good morning, everybody. All right, my name is Z Parker. I got a nonprofit business, and it's called CP Investment Groups. And I provide a house for individuals with low incomes for veterans, elderly, and individuals to provide a house.
Okay, awesome. Next.
I'm John Thompson, president of Office Building Brokers. We're a commercial real estate firm specializing in helping companies lease office space and purchase buildings, as well as the government sector, leasing and selling government space. And something about me, I am a Buckeye.
All right. Go Buckeye.
Hello, I'm Jennifer Kim. I'm operations manager at Office Building Brokers. So I help the company function and help us help our clients find the buildings and properties that they need. And fun fact, I'm training for my second half Ironman next month.
Okay, awesome. In the middle here.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Tommy Henson. I'm in the arts and entertainment industry. And fun fact, well, I'm producing at Laughter Black Theater Festival, where I literally do 40 plays for 4 days.
Wow.
So it's theater marathon. And I've been there for 30 years. This is coming.
Awesome. And then back here.
Good morning. My name is Mel Marshall, company that I help and associates and the Strategic Network. I help nurse practitioners align with the next level of their career, so nurse coach. And well, I was born in New York and I like to make it.
Okay, awesome. All right. Woo. There you go.
Good morning. My name is Andrew Igaro, and my company is called Bear Hunt.
Wow, I like that.
And it's a marketplace for startups. So if you have a startup that you are trying to sell, or you think you might need a partner, you're looking for a partner, then you come to our site and you can anonymously search for a partner.
Okay, well, we need to talk, yeah, because we got a lot of starters that come through here, so we need your services, yeah.
That would be helpful, yeah. Mm-hmm. And a fun fact, I used to have
hair. I think that's true with a few of us in here. One, two, I'm going that direction myself, so. All right.
How's it? Good morning, everyone. I'm Michael Todd, retired from the city of Atlanta. And I have an entertainment production company where I provide songs for art.
Okay, awesome. And then those of you joining us online, we'll give you your 15 seconds of fame. So I'm going to start off, I'm going to unmute you. And so go ahead and get ready to speak. I'm going to call out your name and go ahead and get ready to speak. So I'm going to start with Andrea. So Andrea, go ahead and share about you, your business, and some fun fact or something unique about you.
Good morning. Excuse me. This is Andrea Burnett from Powerhouse Pest Control. So we kill bugs and we provide clean, pest-free environments for our residential, commercial, and our government clients. Something unique about me is that I love to sing.
All right. I think that's everybody. And tell us about your recent contract win.
Yes, we just recently started the contract with Clayton County Water Authority. So we were able to, started the production on Monday. So it was our first opportunity to service them. So far so good, it's going well.
Okay, awesome. I have to say that Andrea has been one of our longest standing members. And, you know, even though she's winning contract, she's continuing to come to learn and keep you know, expanding her knowledge. Because you never, it's kind of like learning English, right? You know, I've been in the U.S., you know, almost 40 years of my adult life, and I'm still learning new words. And so, so you're always learning, and you never arrive in the government market. So, good job on your win. Congratulations on your win, and you know, we appreciate you continuing just to be a part of GCA. All right, so I got Leticia Frazier. I can't unmute you, so maybe your mic is not on. So I'm going to move on and then just get ready for me to come back around, Leticia. And then I've got Penelope Laws. Penelope, go ahead and share about yourself, your company.
Good morning. Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, great. My name is Penelope Laws, and I have the Henpin Corporation. The Henpin Corporation is a staffing, education, and training facility business. And what I am also waiting for my SAMS number, the CAGE number, this week. They said next week for sure. So I can't wait to get in the same position that most of you are in the class. I guess you could say one thing. Maybe not unusual, but I love to train and develop, and I am a professor at Mercer University. So that goes in line with my staffing that I was in HR for over 16 years.
Okay, awesome. And which campus are you in?
I go to all of them. I'm an adjunct faculty, so I even drive to Macon, although I live here in Lithonia. So I go to the Atlanta, Douglas, and Henry County. So I go to all of them.
Okay, sweet. I was, well, thank you.
And thank you. Thank you. And also, I teach counseling and psychology, so you guys may want to come and join my class.
All right. Yeah, just a side fact, this past weekend, I was going fishing, and this young 18-year-old kid hit me from behind. And I was about to get the police to do a report, and I'm thinking, like, man, he looks like a young kid, you know, really good kid. Don't necessarily want to do anything to him. So I talked to his dad, and we worked it out off record, I guess. But he was a Mercer University student. He just went to Mercer in Macon, got all his registration done, and was about to leave for college. And so I thought, you know, I just want to give him, you know, sometimes people need to learn, and I thought that was a good break for him. Yeah. So, yes. All right. Well, hey, let me come back to Leticia. Leticia, you ready? Okay, Leticia, you are on. We can hear you.
Okay, she got it. I'm scraping it.
We can't hear you, Leticia.
Can you hear me?
Okay, go ahead.
Okay, my name is Leticia Frazier. I'm the CEO of Cinemix, which is a management consulting group. Mostly we've been doing resumes and proofreading. I haven't won a contract or anything like that. Something unique is, I don't know. I don't have anything unique at the moment.
All right, well, hey, thanks for joining us online. All right, well, hey, that's, I appreciate everybody, because sometimes you come and you don't always get a chance to network with each other, so I want to make sure that you at least get to hear everybody else for a quick second so that when this is done, you can at least go and network and get to know each other some more. So we got a latecomer. You want to do a 15-second intro about you and your business?
I am Keith Forrest Taylor, founder of Divorce Intelligence. I'm a John Maxwell certified life coach, trained speaker. I come to lead focus on social media etiquette. People have an unhealthy balance with a digital dependency, also known as smartphone addiction. I was Wonder Woman
All right. All right, so let me share a little bit about myself. Again, my name is Adrian Shaw. I love small businesses. I've started numerous businesses. If I count every single business that I officially actually formed a name and incorporated, it's probably about 15, but if I actually counted all the business I've started, it's about 23, 24. I just love entrepreneurship. I've sold two companies. It's an honor to be able to take all of my life experiences and teach it to other people here at GCA. So I'm an entrepreneur just like you. I understand your pain, I understand your challenges. I remember one of my first business, it was a comic book baseball card shop. I was about 19, 20 years old, and we had a few boxes of baseball cards. It's about the size of that little cubby over there. Small little retail store in Pine Lake, Georgia. Anybody know what Pine Lake is? Mm-hmm. All right, you get a ticket there. Is that how you know it?
I went to the lake this weekend.
So Pine Lake is notorious for writing tickets to people.
Yeah, they do.
And so they got sued, and they finally stopped writing a lot of tickets because they have two traffic lights going through the small little city. Mm-hmm. And if you have anything that seems wrong, they will cite you and pull you over.
They got me for the headline.
They were using it for revenue, and they got sued for that because it was disproportionate compared to other similar sized cities. And they lost that lawsuit, so they're being more fair now. But that was my first business. It was a lot of fun. And then I decided I want to be a missionary for the rest of my life. I sold that business, went overseas, did missionary work for about a year in Thailand. And came back to the U.S. I couldn't get back to Laos, so I'm from originally. So came back to the U.S. and decided that, I'll go test out corporate America. And anybody still in corporate America? All right, a few of you, okay. Corporate America is awesome for some people. But for some people, it's not awesome because you're wired differently, right? You weren't wired for the corporate ladder. You weren't wired for that kind of environment. And so for me, I wasn't wired for that, and I suffocated in corporate America. I was employee of the month. I received all these accolades while I was there, but it just wasn't me. So I decided I'm going to start my own business. I had $300 to my name when I started my next business. And people say, well, how are you going to start a business with $300, right? And for some of you, you're a new startup, and we need to hook up Andrew, right?
That's right.
Because there's a lot of companies, a lot of people like me that have $300 to their name, and they want to find a partner, they want to grow their company. And I knew that business is not about money, right? What is business about?
Relationship.
About relationship. It's about networking. It's about people. It's really just about people, understanding people. And understanding people that have problems and people that have solutions. It doesn't have to be your solutions. And you can make money. And that's really like Amazon business model, right? When Amazon started, did they have any products to sell? It was just a portal. And people had products and people have a need. And they connected the two, and that's how they are. They will become probably the world's largest, or the U.S., at least the U.S., the largest corporation in the history of the world. Bigger than Walmart, bigger than Google, bigger than Facebook, bigger than anything. But in other words, it's a platform connecting people with a problem and people with a solution, and that's how they make money. Think about Google. Google started off as a search engine. Before there's Google Maps and Google Earth and Google Ventures and all these different Google things. Search portal. They didn't really have a product or a service. They just had a portal. Somebody come and say, I'm looking for something, and they connected them to somebody that has something. And so I understood that about business. I said, business is about just finding a problem, finding a solution, and you make money, right? So I started with that office furniture business, and I grew that business. My first warehouse was a small 10 by 10 storage unit. That's my first warehouse. So it doesn't matter where you start, right? It's where you want to go. And because I couldn't afford a real warehouse, so I've got a 10 by 10 storage unit. And I remember my first business deal in that furniture business. I found somebody that needed furniture, and I found somebody that had furniture, and I connected the two, and they, it was a $4,000 transaction, and I made $500. And I thought, I can do this here. And I kept on reinvesting my money. 5 years later, I've amassed $10 million with the furniture. I decided to sell that business. I got into real estate, started flipping properties initially. Never been to the hood in Atlanta. And so I went to, you know, an area of town that I thought, oh, yeah, this is an up-and-coming area. Didn't know for sure. You know, I thought, well, hey, I see BMWs driving through the neighborhood. I see all these nice cars. And I thought, you know, it's an up-and-coming neighborhood. As it turns out, after I closed on the house, I went there to start doing renovation. As it turned out, it was a drug house next door. And that's why there was all these nice cars coming through, right? But, you know, we stuck with it. We actually made $50,000 on that first flip, that first property. And so I got into real estate, started building communities, decided that I was going to eventually be a commercial broker and all these different things, and then the real estate market crashed. And we had about communities that we were building, real estate assets that we were amassing, about $20 million of property disappeared in a year and a half. And it was really tough because in business, as an entrepreneur, right, there's some good times, there's some challenging times,
yes.
And you got to be able to work through all of that. When things are going well, don't get too high on your horse.
Right.
And when things are tough, don't get too low. And so, because that's just business, that's just part of it. And so you got to, you know, keep on moving forward. And then I decided that, you know, I wanted to, didn't know what to do next. We filed business bankruptcy, personal bankruptcy. It was some really tough times, lots of tears during those days there. But I made a decision. I decided I was going to invest in my business. I can't pay for my mortgage, can't pay for my car. The repo man came and took the car. The bank came and took the house. But I decided that I have to keep the office. Can't afford my, you know, personal payments. Why should I keep the office, right? Doesn't make any sense. So I went to the property manager and I said, hey, you can let me stay or you can kick me out. And she said, well, I can't let you stay for free. And I said, I understand, it's a business and, you know, just let me stay for what I can afford. Now, this is how you know that the Holy Spirit is speaking on your behalf, right? Because if it was me speaking, what I can afford is zero, right? But the Holy Spirit spoke for me, and sometimes you just got to go with the Spirit as it guides you. Because she said, you know, I said, let me stay for what I can afford. She actually said, well, what can you afford? So now I'm kind of like, oh, okay. So out of my mouth, the words, not my words, the words came out $500 a month. The lease payment there for the office space was about $2,000 a month. Now, I was thinking she's going to say no, and I'm going to be okay, right? But she said yes. So now I'm on the hook for $500. I can't pay my mortgage, can't pay my car note, but how am I going to pay $500? But as an entrepreneur, what do? You figure it out, right? You walk in the step of this voice that tells you what to do, and you just take a step of faith. Because entrepreneurship, if you knew that you have a client every single day, everybody would be in business. If you knew that the government is going to award you a contract, guarantee you a contract, everybody would be a government contractor. But you step out there on faith and you say, hey, you know what? I don't know when it's going to happen, but I believe it's going to happen. And you just walk out there. So I didn't know what to do. And so I wrestled with it for a few days. I asked her to give me 30 days. And so I thought, you know, the average person, back then it wasn't a smartphone, it was a flip phone. The average person has about 120 names on their phone. Now, most of you entrepreneurs, you don't have 120, you got about 1,000 people, right? And so I had about probably 500-600 names in my phone. And I decided to click the little arrow. Back then, you can just scroll like this, right? You have to click the arrow down, 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 down. And I called a few people that has businesses, and I found two that were working from home, that I convinced them that they needed to have an office, a real office. They asked me, so how much is it? I said, 250. So about two people, 250 each, covered my office space. I had no business, didn't know what I was gonna do, but I knew I needed to keep the office, and that's how I reinvested in myself in that way, took a step of faith. And that's how GCA came about, because I came into my empty office, empty every day. Somebody was meeting, using my conference room, didn't know who they were. And I walked in, I said, what are you guys talking about? And this gentleman, he was a lieutenant colonel, he retired from the Army. He was a former contracting officer for 11 years. 22 years in, half of those years, he was a procurement contract officer. He said, we're talking about government contracting. And I said, you know, I don't know anything about it, tell me more. So he started telling me about government contracting, and he says, wow, you don't know. And learn all, you know, 3 hours later, he gave me a whole lesson on government contracting. He said, well, what do you do? I said, well, absolutely nothing right now. And I told him that I'm an entrepreneur, and you know, life is hard, and I don't want to feel depressed. I'm coming to the office every day, even though I have nothing to do. So he said, well, you know what? I need somebody that knows business. Because he knew procurement, and he needed somebody that understood business. And he said, we should do something together. See, when you walk in the spirit, right? Sometimes things come along that is meant to be. So he said, we should do something together. And I said, well, we just met. But I was telling the Lord yesterday that he's got to point me in the right direction. He's got to open up a window so I can jump through it. And here we are talking today. And so maybe this is meant to be, but why don't you take a few days to think about it? I'll take a few days to think about it. So the next day he calls me and he said, hey, you know what? I thought about it. We need to do something. So that's kind of how I got into the government space. We did some work together. We started a consulting company, helped a lot of businesses grow their companies, but it kept on running into a lot of small businesses that cannot afford our consulting services. Because we charge $50,000, $100,000, $150,000 for people to hire us to teach them how to do government contracting. And I run into a lot of small businesses that can't afford that right there. And I thought, how do I help the small business community? And I think back to one of my heroes, Congressman John Lewis. He said that we have to stand in the way of injustice. And what's happening in the government market, there's an economic injustice that's going on. And a lot of social injustice stems from economic injustice, right? And sometimes you think that it's the other person that needs to march, that needs to demonstrate, that needs to go out there and represent the community. Or if you have the knowledge and the power to do something, if you see yourself in the mirror over and over, you say, you know what, I am that person. And so I decided to leave consulting and start the Government Contractors Association so that we can create the tools, the training programs, and make it where anyone can get into the government space. And that's kind of how GCA got here. So that's a little about me and why we're here. But now, for the work that we've done, we received President Obama's Lifetime Achievement Award, the Global Humanity Award, the Goodwill Ambassador for Georgia Award for what we've done. We've taught over 10,000 companies, but more importantly, we've helped businesses win over $900 million in government contracts. And I want all of you here and those of you online to be part of, we want to be part of your journey, and together we want to get to $1 billion. And all of this is small business owners. We have brand new companies, startups that are winning contracts, millions of dollars in contracts now, and we have, you know, seasoned businesses that's part of this journey, and we want you to be part of that journey too. All right, so let's talk about surplus properties. That's what we're here today. So what are surplus properties? Surplus properties is managed by GSA at the federal level, and then every county, every state, every single government agency has a surplus program. And surplus properties can be surplus equipment, could be many things, and we'll talk about some of the different items there. At the federal level, I'm gonna focus more at the federal level because they have a specific program to support the small business community. It's really managed by GSA, but they have a website called GSA Access. And you guys should have the list, the printout, and so you can access that there. So when a federal agency, when they have property that they don't need anymore, like for example, you have an office of, you know, 300 government employees, and they have five big printers there, and then they say, well, you know, it's time to get a new printer. And so they get a new printer. Well, they only have space for five printers, and the other printer, they have to do something with it. It still works fine. You know, they just want to get a new printer because they have the budget to get a new printer. They have to do something with that property. And so the first thing that they have to do is they have to make that property available to other agencies, other federal agencies. So that's the first step. They say, okay, hey, they alert GSA. They say, hey, GSA, we want to catalog this item and we want to make it available. It's kind of like a trade bank. So they make it available, and on GSA Access, other federal agencies can come and say, well, we need a printer. And they earn credits, kind of like a credit system, a barter system to some degree. And then other agencies said, well, we have this surplus, and they put it onto this with GSA and GSA Access. And then they trade properties back and forth. Well, a lot of those properties sits there and no one claims it, right? No other agencies say, you know, we got budget too. We just bought a new, you know, we bought a new printer. We don't need another printer. And so they say, well, we have to do something with that printer. If it's, they have 21 days. If it sits there for 21 days and, you know, nothing happens to it, then they have to do something with that property. And so then it goes to the next phase. So it sits there for 21 days. Now, if it's certain properties, I think if it's laptops or computers, it's really 14 days. But most items, furniture and other items, is 21 days. So they have to declare it as surplus property at this point here. Then they transfer that property to the state where the item is located. So if it's, you know, the SBA office and they have a printer, extra printer, it goes to the state of Georgia. If it's the Federal Reserve, if it's any, the CDC, any federal agency that receive federal funding, when they have surplus property and they can't trade it to other agency, then they have to hand it over to the state. Oh, in this case, the state of Georgia. And then the state of Georgia is actually, it is actually responsible for distributing it to the proper qualified entity or the qualified small business. So that's really the flow of how it's done. And if you have questions, you know, feel free to just raise your hand and ask as we go through this process here. So what kind of properties or equipment are available? Cell phones. They got to do something with cell phones, right? Laptops and desktops. I've seen some of those. Office furniture. When GSA and federal agency, when they buy furniture, they don't buy the particle board furniture from Office Depot. They buy the steel case furniture. They buy the Harman Miller furniture. They buy the desk that is about $4,000 or $5,000. They buy the chairs, the Aeron chairs that if you sit on it, you're floating on cloud. They buy the good stuff, okay? So they're not buying the cheap stuff where you have to hand assemble, you know, using a screwdriver. They buy the good stuff. So the furniture lasts forever. They buy, you know, and I used to be in the furniture business, so I see the quality of the type of items that they buy. You can get generators. You can get any type of equipment, maybe from farm equipment to printer equipment to anything like that there. Almost anything that you can imagine, that any type of things that you as a business owner would need, they probably have it. So let's look at a few examples. And this is a list, but I'm actually going to go to the state of Georgia's website and share with you a little bit of what they do have. So let's go and look.
Going
Oh, is it the internet? Because I was just on there last night. It was, you know, all this thing was working. Oh, Richard is fine. Can you tell Richard that's fine? All right, so I come here and I look for different items. You know, if I'm looking for clothing, books, agriculture, machinery and equipment, ADP equipment, monitors, they got some monitors right now. So they've got Dell monitor, 20 inch. You click on that there, and it tells you they have 10 of these here. And it's what is it?
New.
New, still in boxes, okay. It's a process, and we're going to talk about the details of the process today. So it's new in a box, and it's here in Atlanta, you know, because, and then you click on it, and you actually get a nice picture of, you know, what it looks like. So brand new. It's a monitor, a computer monitor, 20 inch. So it's this, you know, pretty sizable. It's not, you know, your small little monitor. It's a sizable monitor. So this is one items. Let's come back and let's look for another item here. So let's, for those of you who are in the medical supply industry, let's see what they have. So they have a Cavitron Jet Densely Ultrasonic Scaler. I have no idea what this is. EMS Piezon Master 400 Ultrasonic Scanner. And let's look at this here. So they have two of these here. And condition is not really good, but you know, notes, yeah, and it doesn't necessarily mean that it doesn't, you can't repair it, but they're giving you what they do know, right? All of this here is you get it as is, there's no guarantee of anything like that. And then you, it looks still pretty decent to me. Well, if you're in the dental world, you know, if you're in the dental business, you know exactly what this is. For the rest of us, if you have a dental business, you know, this is what you want, right? So this is about a brand new one. Used is $1,100. This one is used is $520. So it's about, you know, $2,000-$3,000 equipment. Used is about $500 to $1,200. And how much can you get it for?
Free.
Usually there's a small admin fee. And the admin fee is in this situation $50. So usually the admin fee is, you know, it could range in from $5 to about $50. It's usually not more than $50. But feel free to go and play around with it. All the other items that they have. Let me look at one more. Office supplies and devices, office machines. Let's look at this here. Office machines, they got lots of items. Okay. Lots. So they got this printer here. They got, what is it, Martin Yale? What is it? some type of specialized printer. It's a printer component or something. Yeah. But feel free to play around and search to see what they have. And as a business, I'm going to show you how you can get it for free. Just pay this admin fee with it. Now, you know, I said, is it really free, right?
No.
You know, it's free regardless of the value. You just have to pay the administrative fee. Most items is $5 to $50. There are some really expensive items that's a little bit more. But you know, for most of the things you guys will be getting, it's a very small admin fee. And I'd rather pay that small admin fee than buy brand new for $2,000 to $3,000, right? All right, so who can obtain these surplus properties? Anybody that, if you are a government agency, you can access it. If you are a nonprofit, and we'll talk about the type of nonprofits that can access it. Anybody here has a nonprofit or works for a nonprofit? Yeah, okay, three of you. So we're gonna talk about how to do that there. Educational institutions, there's different types that they're actually can qualify for this here, and small businesses. So these are the different type. It's kind of small, but when you go to the site, it will actually give you a bigger picture of this here. So if you are a public agency, like a government agency, volunteer, fire, and rescue, if you were tied to any of the fire and rescue as a public servant in that regard, if you have a nonprofit educational organization, a 501c3, if you have a nonprofit museum, a nonprofit in health or wellness, if you have a nonprofit that works with the homeless, you just kind of go through their qualifications and you can get it. If you have a nonprofit that deals with the, you know, impoverished community or the elder community nonprofit or other type of nonprofits, and you just have to kind of validate that to see and ask them to, you know, work with you. There's the, you know, we'll talk about who you're gonna work with, but they'll go through it to make sure that you can get it as a nonprofit. Or if you are service education activity, any charter or private organization, but you know, still in the educational side of things. Or if you are VSO, veteran service organization, anything that ties to supporting veterans. Or if you are a SBA certified 8A company, or you are a SBA, or you know, it's managed by the SBA, but it's actually the VA certified company, VOSB or SDVOSB. So you can also get that. This is a new program, just passed as law this year. It was approved last year, it became law this year, and we'll talk about some of those details in a second. So any questions about qualifications, type of entity, and all right, so let's talk about you know, the program and why it's here. Congress created these special programs, specifically, you know, the 8A and the veteran-owned business program to support the small business community. And all the other, I'm not gonna focus on all the other nonprofits and so forth, you know, for the rest of this year, I'm gonna talk about business and you as individual as we go forward. So there's two programs that qualify for the free surplus property program, 8A Business Development Program, and the Veteran-Owned Small Business Program. And so if you have any of these certifications, and I'm gonna talk about if you're not certified yet, how you can get the certifications in a little bit. And all these two programs is managed by the SBA. Or the surplus program. Now the VOSB is managed by the VA, and then the 8A program is managed by the SBA. But the surplus program is actually through the SBA itself, which coordinate with the state to transfer the property to you. So let's talk about the 8A program. So for the 8A certification program, this is it is under the Small Business Act under Section 8A, and this is the specific program for the surplus property under Section 15 636, all that, not that critical for you guys, but you know, it's a law, regulation that allows you as a business to get the free furniture. So, and for the veteran, BOSB and Service Disabled Veteran with Small Business, it was introduced as a bill, and then it passed as the Veteran Small Business Enhancement Act, which became law in 2018, but it was activated in January 2019. And so, this is the program here. And so if you are a veteran and you get certified as a BOSB or SDVOSB, you can get free furniture and surplus properties. So why is this important to you, right? Well, one is if you get it for free, it saves you money. You can use your money instead of investing in furniture and office equipment and office supplies. Use it to get marketing. Use it to build relationships, to network, and use it for other purposes, right? It keeps your business overhead low because furniture can be expensive. And you know, when you buy furniture, like a projector like this here is like $1,200. You can get it for free. Pay 10 bucks, 15 bucks for a processing fee, you get it for free. Tables, like the tables that you guys have your equipment, your phones that you're sitting on, those tables are about 250 each. The just the footstand, one of those footstand is about $75 to $100 each. Yeah, just that stand there, they sell for $75 to $150 each. And you can get it for free, you know, through these programs here. So you can get any type of furniture, you can get chairs and so forth too, right? It keeps your overhead low so you can, you know, invest in other areas. It allows you to bid lower price. If your overhead is lower, you can be more competitive when you're bidding on projects. Because some projects is what they call LPTA. Anybody know what LPTA stands for? Lowest price, technically acceptable. Almost there. So you're almost speaking Governese. You guys are getting there. Lowest price, technically acceptable. Well, if your overhead is low, that means when you're bidding on it, other companies have higher overhead.
Right.
And so they're going to bid at a higher price. And if lowest price means that they're going to start off with the company that has the lowest price on the bid. And they're going to see if they're technically acceptable, means that do they meet all the requirements? And then if they don't, they go to the next lowest price to see if that lowest price can meet all the requirement. And if they don't, they go to the third and to the fourth until somebody actually qualifies and meet all the technical requirement for that project there. And so that's what LPTA means. They start off with, they try to see the lowest price to see if they qualify first. And if you are the lowest price or close to the lowest price, you have a better chance of getting the contract. Now, the opposite of that is best value. Best value just means that price is secondary and they want to find the most qualified company that's going to provide the best value, the best service, best product to the government. But if you have low overhead, you're going to have a low price to the government market. And you're going to make more profit, right? If you keep your costs low, you're going to make more profit. So by getting $15,000, $20,000 of furniture to equip your office, now you're going to have more money to do other things. And ultimately, you can bid lower. You're going to make more profit with that there. So where can you get these surplus items? When it goes from the agencies ultimately down to the state, it goes to an organization called SASP, S-A-S-P. SASP manages the surplus properties. And I'll give you a definition of what that is in a second. And sometimes some property goes to auction sites. So if nobody claims it through SASP, right? It sits there, they say, hey, we got to get rid of it. No one's claiming these items. Then they have to auction it off. So that's how they ultimately dispose of it. Now, if it's not working, if it's trash, they actually just recycle it and, you know, or throw it away. But if it's working and it's not ready for, you know, trash, the federal regulation says they must put it through this surplus property process here. They can't just dump it if it's working. They can't just throw it away. They have to go through this process here. And so if no one claims it through SASP, the state agency, then they have to auction it off. So how does that work? SASP stands for State Agency for Surplus Property. Every state has a SASP. State Agency for Surplus Property. The link is provided for you. So SASP is a state agency responsible for distributing surplus property to eligible recipients. They monitor its use and manage the future retention, transfer, or disposal of the property if appropriate. They do monitor the use. It's not like they're gonna come into your office and say, hey, you still got it? You know, if you use it, and at some point, if you don't use it, you don't need it anymore, you return it back to them, or they will say, hey, you can do whatever you want with it. So that's what they mean by monitoring and maintaining the life of that property there. Or if it's no longer working, you can't just throw it away. You have to let them know so that they can say, okay, you can properly dispose of it. And so you can't, you know, just call, you know, somebody from Craigslist, come and pick it up and you're done with it. There is a protocol to it. So how is it transferred to you? First, you have to obtain your small business certification, your 8A or veteran certification. So that's the first step. Once you attain your certification, then you go and you apply to SASP, and the link for the application, I'll show you in a second. You have to apply to SASP and get approved to be a recipient of the items. Once you get approved, then you start searching for the properties that you want. And when you find it, you let them know, and then they transfer it to you through the SBA. Because the SBA manages really, you know, the process on the government side. And so they will coordinate with the SBA, say, okay, hey, this company has been approved to receive these five laptops or these five Dell monitors or these, you know, two desk or chairs or whatever. And then they will transfer the property from SASP, alerting the SBA, putting on record that you received the items, and then you can use the items to help your business to grow. So that's kind of the flow here. So how do you search for, you know, the SASP in your area? So you want to use this link here. This is the link. If you're not in Georgia, for those of you online, if you're not in Georgia, I gave you the Georgia link earlier. But if you just want to search for, if you have a family member that has a veteran business in Kentucky or in California, they can use this link here to search for the SASP in their state and then engage the SASP to get their free surplus property. Now for Georgia, this is who the director right now, Steve Elkin or Eakin, and this is his email address. And you know he's part of the Department of Administrative Services with the state of Georgia, and he handles the surplus property division. And this is their address and his phone number. And this is the link directly to their program here. So if you're in the state of Georgia, this is who you need to engage. Now, if you want to start the application process and you're in Georgia, then this is the link to it right here. And you start the application. If you are already certified as a 8A, veteran-owned business, then go ahead and just start the application process. Now, once you get the items, can you return it?
Uh-huh. You can apply simultaneously.
No, you have to wait till you're certified as a business first, then you apply for the furniture or surplus property program. Now, once you receive the item, can you return it? There is a no return policy. And there is a no refund policy. You can't get your administrative fees. Your $5 is gone forever. So there is a no return policy unless you decide that you're going to close down your business, you decide that you're going to sell your business, you decide that you're going to do something with your business and you no longer need it, then at their discretion, they can choose whether they want to receive it back or you have the rights to dispose of it or do whatever you want with it. And they will give you the authority to do that. But there is a no return, no refund policy. So how can you use the surplus property, right? You can use a surplus property for your veteran 8A business in the course of conducting normal business operation. If you have a home office, you can use it, you know, if you can get a desk for your home office, and that's fine. It's part of your normal operation. If you get a printer, you can use it to print your business, you know, documents and different things like that. If it's part of your normal business operation, then you can use it. There's, you know, that's what it's meant for. It may not be sold, transferred to any other party, including affiliates, until 1 year after the concerned graduates from the 8A program, or in the veteran program, you don't actually graduate. So you cannot transfer, sell it, or do anything else with it outside of using it for your business. If you are caught, some of you, you may not heed to this here, so I'm going to tell you now to heed to it. You cannot sell it. If they find out that you sold it or transferred it, you will lose your certification. So it's not worth making the extra $50 or $200. You know, just use it for what it's intended for. If you don't need it, let them know. They can choose to pick it up, or they can choose to say, okay, you can do whatever you want with it at that point. But there is a little bit of responsibility in receiving these properties here. So those are the guidelines here. So how do you get 8A certified? Well, the 8A program, the qualification is, it's a social economic disadvantage program. You get 8A certified, you can get the surplus property, but you have to economically and socially qualified to be in the 8A program. So what does that mean? Social disadvantage means this here. If you are a African American, Asian American, Hispanic American, or from certain ethnic group or certain countries, then you are automatically considered socially disadvantaged. Now, if you can prove, if that's not you, and you are the majority and not part of the minority community, then you have to prove that you are socially disadvantaged with what they call a preponderance of evidence. Now, that's very broadly determined in that way, with a preponderance of evidence, meaning that you can be, if there's a physical disability, you can potentially use that to say that you are socially disadvantaged in the workforce, in the business community, because of your disability. But you have to prove it through medical records and other different things. So that can potentially be part of your proof. Or there's a lady, she's a member of GCA. She's a white, you know, female, and she was sexually harassed at her job. She sued the company and won the court case. And so she decided that I'm not gonna go and work for another company, I'm gonna start my own business. So she used that court case as her preponderance of evidence to validate that she's socially disadvantaged, and she started her business so that she would never be in that position again. And so that's how she got into the 8A program. Or there was another, a friend of mine, he told me about a Hasidic Jew who is, you know, he is Orthodox and he wears the full outfit. And because of that, there's been lots of documented instances of where he was socially discriminated against, and he used that to get into the 8A program. So there's different reasons. It's not a minorities program that most people think it is. It's a social disadvantaged program. Anyone can get into the program. But if you are part of the minority community, there's a history a pattern of social disadvantage already so that you automatically are presumed socially disadvantaged. Now, the economic part has to do with this, sir, right? The company has to be owned by 51% of a minority-owned company, or the person has to prove that they're socially disadvantaged. And the economic part just means that your net worth is less than $250,000 to get into the 8A program. Now, what does that mean? Net worth is loosely defined, right? Net worth as not how we define it, but net worth in terms of how the government defines it. Now, the way they define it is they don't count the value of your business. Because traditionally, if you have a business, there's value to that, and that's part of your net worth. But for qualification to the 8A program, they don't count the value of your business. Your business could be worth $1 million. They don't count it. They don't count your primary residence. So the home that you own, you live in, they don't count that as part of your net worth. So it could be worth $1 million, or it could be worth $20,000. They don't count that towards this $250,000. They don't count your retirement money. So if you have money in 401k, in long-term retirement accounts, they don't count that there. And so you can actually, declare it as part of your 401k. Now, if it's in your regular savings account, you have to declare it. Unless it's in a qualified long-term retirement account, then you don't count it. You still disclose it, but they don't count it towards your net worth, because they want you to list all your assets when you're applying for your 8A certification. And any real estate that you own outside of your primary, they do count. They count those things there. But you know, most people, most of your net worth is tied to the home that you live in, tied to your business, and tied to your retirement. So most people I know falls under the $250,000 net worth. Now, for any reason, your net worth is higher than that, then they do allow you to transfer your asset. So, you know, most of you, if you're kind of like on the bubble, you're like, oh, you know what, I'm 251,000 net worth. And, you know, we could talk about how to transfer it. We talked to the SBA, and you can actually create a trust, transfer, like if you own a second home, like a vacation home in Florida or something like that, that's worth more than $250,000 after the debt to it, you can transfer it to an irrevocable trust. Now, I'm not an attorney, so I'm just giving you an understanding of it. If you're going to do it, seek the proper guidance to do it properly. But you create an irrevocable trust, meaning that the trust, once it's created, it cannot be changed. And then you make your kids or somebody else a beneficiary to it. And in that situation, you are no longer the beneficiary. The asset does not belong to you anymore. Now, you can stay as a trustee of the trust. Now, as a trustee, you have the rights to sell it. You have the rights to do whatever you want with it as a trustee. So if your kids are the beneficiary, but you're the trustee, you can act on the property on behalf of your kids. And so that's totally allowable as well. But we can talk more details about how that works in a deeper conversation. And the way you get certified into the 8A program is go to certified.sba.gov. It's a very lengthy process. It is probably one of the hardest things you're going to do in the government market is getting certified into the 8A program. We do have the all-day boot camp tomorrow that will help you through navigate some of the details. For today, I can only give you high level because there's lots and lots of details. Most businesses, when they apply the first time, many of them get turned down because they didn't do it properly. And if for any reason you get turned down, you have to wait a whole nother year before you can apply into the program. If you are a brand new company, you don't qualify for the 8A yet. You have to be in business for 2 years before you can apply to be in the 8A program. Now, question?
No, I was saying for to get certified, right?
Yes, you have to be certified as an 8A company to get the free furniture, free surplus items. Yes.
2 years.
You have to be in business for 2 years for the 8A certification. Now, if you're a veteran-owned business, you don't have to be in business 2 years. You can just get certified into the veteran program and go after the free property. Say louder.
With a nonprofit organization, you have to have the organization for 2 years?
No. Okay. Oh. Nonprofit, you qualify not under the business program. You qualify as a nonprofit, and through the nonprofit, you can go directly to SASP and just go through their application process. And then they will validate you, which is different from the small business program.
Oh, God.
But if you use a nonprofit, you can only use the furniture for your nonprofit. You cannot use it for your for-profit business. So keep that in mind. And because it's two different programs and it's designed for different reasons. But that's how you get certified here. Now, if you are a veteran and you want to get veteran certified through the VA, they have a what they call a Vets First program. The Vets First program with the VA says that every single government contract that they have, they want to award it to a veteran-owned business first before anybody else. That's why they call it Vet First. Just like the Section 3 program, right? Section 3 is with HUD, and HUD says, you know, they want to award a contract to Section 3 certified company first before they award it to any other type of businesses. If you're in real estate, HUD is one, it should be one of your main client, and you want to look into the Section 3 program. Anybody that in construction, in renovation, anything tied to property, real estate, facilities management, you want to get the Section 3 program, but that's something different. But today, the Vet First program is through the VA, and you have to be the vet, the owner of the business have to be 51% or more, a veteran, and 51% owner of the company or more. If you are the veteran and your partner is not a veteran and it's a 50-50% setup, then you want to transfer 1% from your partner to you permanently. It can't just be like, you know, for a few months until you qualify into the program or into the veteran program. It's a permanent transfer. Now, once you decide that you don't want to be a veteran business anymore, you can do whatever you want with your shares. You can sell it back to your partner. You can do whatever you want. But while you're in the program, you have to maintain 51% ownership of the company, or the veteran has to maintain that there. Now, there's two main programs. There's the VOSB and the SDVOSB. The difference is VOSB stands for Veteran-Owned Small Business. SDVOSB stands for, what does SD stands for? Service Disabled Veteran-Owned Small Business. And so if you have a choice between the two, which one is better?
Service
Disabled Veteran-Owned Small Business is the better one. The VOSB is good for DOD, Department of Defense, and the VA. Whereas the SDVOSB is good for all agencies. All agencies uses the SDVOSB. Whereas the VOSB is only for DOD and the VA. So it opens up more doors for you by actually getting into the SDVOSB program. Now, to get into the SDVOSB program, you just need 1% disability. That's it. If you're a veteran, I'm pretty sure I can find something wrong with you. In fact, for all of you here, I'm pretty sure I can find something wrong with you too, right? Just like something's wrong with me as well. You know, if I start twitching, it's because, you know, I'm have some type of issue. 1% or more. That's service related. Yeah. It has to be validated through medical records. So it's either done through the your private doctor or the VA itself.
Done post separation?
Yeah. It can be done post.
Okay, so it has to be done with your separation.
Correct. When you receive your DD-214 and you're discharged, and there's nothing wrong with you at that point, that it doesn't matter. You can still say, hey, you know what? I was a tanker, and you know, all that loud noise is causing some hearing loss. Or, you know, I fell while I was doing this here, and they checked me out at that time, nothing was wrong, but now I feel the effect of it. You know, now that I'm a little bit older, I feel the effect of it. and you, as long as you can link it back to your military experience, then you can get the certification. Other questions around this program?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Do you have to be like in the military to do it?
You have to have military experience. As long as you have military experience, it doesn't matter if you're in there as a reserve, it doesn't matter if you're there for 1 year, as long as you are a veteran, then you can get into this program. Honorably discharged, yes. If you was not honorably discharged, then you cannot get into the program. And for the certification, this is the link where you go and start your veteran certification application process. This is, they're gonna, just some general stuff. They're gonna require your typically 2-3 years tax return. They're gonna require your business tax return, your personal tax return. They're going to require proof that you own the business, your shares, your business meeting minutes, anyone that owns any part of the company. They're gonna ask for who those people are. Lots of documentation goes along with this process. And so be prepared to go through at least, if you are a pretty organized person for the 8A and for the veteran certification, or at least the SDVSB, be prepared about 2 to 3 months to gather all the things that you need to gather. If you're super organized, it may be just 2 weeks. But, you know, 2 to 3 months is kind of normal, getting all your paperwork ready. Once you submit the paperwork, then the government have about 90 days to approve or not approve you. Now, if they're saying that they lost your paperwork, or they never start the clock on your paper, if you submit it, but they never acknowledge that they receive it, then the clock doesn't start. Until they acknowledge that they received the package, then the clock starts ticking on that 90 days. For the 8A program, even though they promise you, you know, they say 90 days, historically, it's been about 6 months to 12 months. So you know, they may say 90 days, but they might say, I need your tax return. And if they're asking for paperwork, the clock doesn't start for them. And it may take 4 or 5 months for them asking for paperwork from you, even though you submitted it. And they has been notorious for losing documents, or even though it's there, they're gonna ask for you to submit it again. And if they ask, just give it to them again. Don't fight them, you know, don't say, whatever, I gave it to you on this day. Here's the email again. You know, just say, okay, here it is again. Just work with them. And that's how you get your certification. It's very powerful, because with your certifications, you can do more than just get free furniture and free equipment. You can get sole source contracts. And what are sole source contracts? Exclusive contract for one company. So sole source is a very powerful tool. If you get your certifications, 8A mainly, veteran as well, women can also get sole source contract, although I've never seen a woman receive sole source contract yet. But the sole source program is available for women-owned businesses and hub-zone companies as well. Mainly, sole source is done through the 8A program. And if you have a relationship with the agency and they trust that you can handle the work in the 8A program, anything less than $4 million, they can do a direct award to your company without having to compete with anybody else. Very powerful. At the federal level. Now, at the state, county level, they don't use certification for sole source, but they do have sole source contracting authority as well. And if you are the only, like you develop a technology and you're the only company to have it, they can sole source it to you, because they do what they call justification. Like if you develop a program that supports the homeless for the city, and you're the only one that has a specific process and no one else can do in the world, they can sole source it to you. Or you develop a software and you're the only one that has the software, they can sole source it to you. Or if it's less, like for the city of Atlanta, if it's less than $25,000, they can sole source it to a company without having to openly compete. If you're trying to do work for the state of University of Georgia, you know, as a Buckeye fan, you should do work for the state of Georgia. University of Georgia, they buy a lot of stuff. If you want to do work for Board of Regents, anything tied to university system, I think the contracting authority threshold is about $10,000. So most of our focus is around federal because the threshold is $4 million. So if you're going to spend time building relationships, do it for the higher threshold, right? All right, so we have an upcoming certification boot camp tomorrow, and I want to tell you a little bit more about that. Certification is very important. It unlocks set-aside contracts, sole source, which I just mentioned. Now, set-asides is another powerful tool that you can use. When they decide to set aside a project for women-owned businesses only, guess what, guys? You can't bid on it unless you team with a women-owned business. So the only way you can bid on it, if they set aside for women-owned business, ladies can compete. If they set aside to veteran-owned business, only veteran-owned business can compete. And if you're interested in the project, like your medical supply, are you a veteran?
No.
So if you want to sell medical supplies to the VA, because they have a Vets First Program initiative, it's to your advantage to partner with a veteran-owned business, because they're going to need to, you know, for other contract, they're going to need a woman-owned business. So, you know, you need them for different reasons, they need you for different reasons, and you come together. Or they might sell janitorial supplies, and they don't do medical supplies. And so they need you to add value in that regard to the VA. And so there's different reasons why companies come together to team in that regard. So set aside is another important tool. So by coming to the certification bootcamp, it's all day from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. We're going to take you through all the different certification, the details of it. Today, I gave you a little bit high level, but imagine, you know, 8 hours of that there, the knowledge that you're going to glean from that there. So it's tomorrow, 9 to 5. And for GCA members or ABC or any of our alliance partners, it's $499. And for non-members, it's $999 for the all-day bootcamp. And if you want to register, there's this link right here. And Myra's going to be doing the class. Myra is our in-house certification expert. She has 99.99999% success rate. Now, the reason why she can't say 100% is because one of the company didn't fully disclose all of the information to her. Because she can only, before you do the certification, she will actually go through the qualification. And if you tell her that, yes, you can do that, yes, you meet those qualifications, then she will do your application. If you don't qualify, she won't do it for you. But one of the companies didn't fully disclose everything, so there's one company that didn't get through. And so they have to fix some of that until they can get back in. But she's a, you know, awesome expert in it. And so she, you know, has, we guarantee you success if we're doing your certification, unless you don't disclose it. If you don't disclose it and we thought you were qualified and you weren't, then the work's already been done at that point. But if you qualify and we're doing your certification, we guarantee that you will be successful in obtaining your certification.
And that's my
ultimate. Yeah. Now, the 8A certification is the hardest one to do. And sometimes you just have to let the expert do it for you, right? If I'm looking for a commercial office space, who do I use? Right? Ms. Thompson, they specialize in commercial property. So why do I need to go get my commercial property license just so I can get a property for myself, right? Doesn't make any sense. If you need to change your oil, who do you use? Right? You go to Jiffy Lube, right? Or yeah. Go to, I mean, I mean, it's not super expensive. Yeah, you can save 30, 40 bucks and do it yourself, but you know, why get your manicure fingernails dirty, right? Let the expert do what they know best. Unless you want to do it yourself, that's fine. But it's super complex. But most of you are smart enough. And so if you're on a tight budget, you can do it yourself. I know many companies that have done it themselves, but if you don't want to use a lot of time to figure it out, read through all the regulations, go through the whole process, then just let the expert do it for you. The certification for the veteran certification is $1,800. Again, when you come to the class tomorrow, you'll learn how to do it for yourself. But if you want to let the expert do it, then that's, you know, that's kind of how, that's the fee for us to do it. Any questions around our certification services? Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. Georgia
yeah.
What's the difference between that and SAS?
It's all falls under the same organization. One is to search for properties, and the other link is to do the application. Okay. So, but it's really the same organization.
Okay.
Just different links.
So it's not the Georgia property. Once after 21 days, it doesn't sell it and go to SAS. SAS is managing.
Yes, SAS manage all of that. Now, before the 21 days, it's actually managed by GSA. If it's federal property. So within the 20, you know, while it's in the 21 day period, GSA manages the properties. And then if it doesn't, no other federal agency claims it, then it's transferred to SAS. And then at that point, SAS manages it. So it, there's a handoff of the property. Mm-hmm. Other questions? Mm-hmm.
I guess my biggest question about me trying to do affordable housing for individuals, veterans, and everyone. I know you're talking about SAP, what would be like the best? I guess I'm asking what would be the best for me to start it.
Sure.
I'll
give you two opinions on that.
Okay.
Two strategies more so. So, well, actually, three. Who's familiar with For Benefit? Anybody? For Benefit. You've heard of nonprofit, right?
Yeah.
All of you have heard of nonprofit. All of you have heard of For Profit.
Yes.
Who's heard of For Benefit? Nobody? Wow. That's the B Corp.
Okay.
The Benefits Corporation, but this For Benefit is different from B Corp. So B Corp is a nonprofit, and you decide that you want to be a social entrepreneur and you want to do good for community and you have a social mandate for your for-profit, then you use the B Corp and they certify you as a B Corp, and then it creates transparency and it values that you're actually doing good for the environment or whatever your social mandate is. Your social mandate may be to serve veterans. Your social mandate might be to educate the disadvantaged community. Your social mandate could be anything. That's the B Corp. The B Corp became so popular that different legislators and different states decided that, you know what, we need to adopt this model and make it official for our state. So now there's about 35 states that have created the For Benefit model. The For Benefit model is like a B Corp, but it's actually an official designation by the state. To where you are a social for-profit organization. So you are a hybrid between a for-profit and a nonprofit. The challenge with a nonprofit is you don't have a revenue model. You have a donation model. And you cannot have profit. And as an entity, if you don't have a revenue model, guess what? Well, you're gonna survive. I know a lot of nonprofit that makes no money, great social mission, but not going anywhere. So that's the weakness to a nonprofit. The weakness to a for-profit is it's all about profit, right? It's all about the shareholders and the stakeholders. And sometimes if there's an oil spill, who cares? We'll just clean it up, you know, if it spills. Or who cares about if you create a manufacturing process that there's some toxic fumes that's released, and as long as it meets the federal requirement, it still releases toxic. And so instead of cleaning it 100%, you say, well, the mandate says we just need to meet, you know, a 90% threshold. You could do 100% if you want to, but you just only do the 9% because that's what required by law. But as a social for benefit organization, you say, hey, we're going to be 100% environmentally free, leave no footprint for the environment as a manufacturing company. And so for benefit have a social mandate and a profit mandate. And so it's a what we call social entrepreneurship, and you have the hybrid of both. The state of Georgia just approved the for benefit model this year. So in the near future, you can actually, when you go to incorporate your new company, you can incorporate as a for-benefit organization where you are a for-profit based upon the IRS rules. The IRS treats you as a for-profit, but you're really a for-benefit and you have a social and profit mission. And so I share that because you're considering with what you're doing, you have a social mandate, but you also want to have a revenue model. So that might be something to consider. Now, outside of that, because in the state of Georgia, even though the regulation have passed into the bill has been passed into law, when they implement it, I still don't have a date yet. And so it might be 6 months, next year, 2 years, and I don't know. Typically, it takes about 6 to 12 months before something is rolled out. So in the event that, or if you do want to be a for benefit, you can organize in the other states like Delaware or some, I think Florida has a for benefit. And then file as a foreign entity in Georgia, or just wait a little bit. But if that's not the path that you want to go now, then you form two companies, two organizations. One is a for-profit, and one is a nonprofit, and then you use that to meet, you know, to meet your social mandate. Yes.
And you just answered my question.
Yeah. And
I actually have a for-profit.
Okay.
But I just like my interest is getting the money. You know, like we talk about real estate flipping. Mm-hmm. Not going to do that for fun, but I wanted to do fundraisers and build up. So I had like a strategy, business plan.
So, but the work that you do, you might as well form a nonprofit tied to it. Now, we do have Richard. We do have a partner that we work with. Okay. And if you decide not to start a nonprofit, one of the organizations that we work with, they will look at your for-profit and match you with a nonprofit and let the nonprofit be kind of like your fiduciary agent and work with you. So if there's anything, grants or things like that, they go through the nonprofit and then they manage, like if it's a $100,000 grant,
right.
They manage the grant, the money goes to your for-profit, but then they are the fiduciary agent and they keep like typically about 3 to 5%. So that we can connect you to a nonprofit and just see Richard. Okay. See Richard about that. If you don't want to form, because when you form a nonprofit, you have to have a board, you have to manage it, and yeah, it just becomes cumbersome to manage a nonprofit as well. Question for you?
It's about the foundation.
Okay. All right.
If you are a for benefit company,
is treated the same for the purposes of the
contracting as a non-profit? No, it's treated as a for-profit. It's treated as a
for-profit. For tax purposes and for contracting purposes, it's treated as a for-profit. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I just got a question. I mean, I know everybody about the land, but with that price, like, is there just a flat price discount? I want to really get that set up.
Sure. So Myra's in the back right there. Myra, raise your hand.
Yeah.
So talk to Myra. If you're in like a unique situation, you say, hey, you know what? I really want to use this service, but I need a different alternative. We do have some other options. And so she can tell you more about the options. All right, so we are at the hour, a little bit past. I've got the boot camp I'm gonna give out. So first hand I see to have the right answer gets this certification discount for the boot camp here. You guys ready?
Yeah.
All right, so here's the question. Now, don't raise your hand if you don't know the answer. You gotta know the answer to raise your hand. What does SAS stands for?
State agency for surplus property.
Okay, all right.
How much is that?
It's $4.99, you get half of my salary. All right, well, hey, everybody, thanks for coming out, and I appreciate, for those of you coming to the registration boot camp or certification boot camp, we'll see you tomorrow. All right, take care, everybody. Hey, for those of you online, if you have any questions, go ahead and ask your questions. All right, so I got some questions online. If you aren't certified, they can come to tomorrow's boot camp. Okay. Oh, did you say earlier that nonprofit organization can use? Let me expand this here so I can see. All right, so the question is, can nonprofit use this program also? Yes, nonprofit can use this program also. Anybody else online with a question before we wrap up here? A nonprofit that supports a for-profit, that's called a fiduciary agent. A fiduciary agent is F-I-D-U-C-A-I-R-Y, agent. So they act on behalf of to support the for-profit. So they're the fiduciary agent. Any other questions for those of you online before we wrap up here? If you have a nonprofit already, you can use your nonprofit and
about the session.
Yes. If you have a nonprofit already, yes, I haven't done it for a nonprofit, but I believe that nonprofit has to be registered in SAM to receive the free furniture program. But if you reach out to the SAS director, they will tell you and validate that, but I'm pretty sure that you do need to be in SAM.gov to receive the program. All right, well, for all of you, yes, if you shoot me an email, and I will shoot me an email. Let me hear. Shoot me an email at info@govcontractors.org. If you shoot me an email and say on the subject line, put free furniture presentation, and I will get that to you. All right, any other comments? All right, folks. Well, thanks for joining us online, and look forward to another session. We'll see you guys next Wednesday for those of you for our next class.